Sup, you beautiful bastards. Hope you've been a fantastic Friday. Welcome back to the Philip DeFranco Show. And if you're new here, on Fridays, we do things a little bit different. On Fridays, I try to cover more stories that I wanted to cover earlier in the week. They ended up getting cut for time, or we wanted to wait for more information, also including a lot more viewer-requested stories. And so with that said, let's just jump into it. And the first thing we're going to talk about today, by far the most requested story as of this morning, is the Casey Neistat-Logan Paul interview. And it's a video that has proven very polarizing before people have even watched it. I mean, this morning, I was getting hit with tweets like this. Bill, will you please cover how Casey Neistat had the audacity to promote sociopathic and self-centered mega douche Logan Paul on the official Casey Neistat channel, and how I don't even have to watch it to not be okay with it. But here's the thing, and I say this, obviously transparency, I'm friends with Casey, but if you've watched this channel, I've been incredibly critical of things Casey has done in the past, and then I'll say the same thing that I said to him when I saw this video. It is 5 times better than his Robert Kinsel video, and he actually does an incredibly good job of calling Logan Paul out on his shit. But he does so in a way where the interview is not completely combative and they're allowed to hit multiple points. But even with the content of the interview being what it was, even Casey Neistat prefaced everything by saying he's still not sure if it was the right thing to do to release it.
To be totally honest, I wasn't sure. I'm still not sure if releasing it is the right thing. I harbor a lot of self-doubt about maybe I was too easy on him. I mean, maybe I was too argumentative with him.
And he also hits on a note of even after he's not sure if Logan Paul is being sincere.
The thing that I hope to learn, my very specific intention with this interview, was to see if he was sincere about what he's trying to accomplish with this documentary, or if the whole thing's just a charade for good PR.
And I will say, personally, after watching the interview, I do not feel like Logan Paul is being sincere and that actual change is happening. That all of this from Logan's end are calculated PR moves meant to make him more money, raise his level of fame. But there are several parts where the words and pacing feel very much like media training. The sheer number of times he refers to himself in the third person or as just a brand.
Is it possible for Logan Paul to make a comeback? That's who I am. That's the brand of Logan Paul. I still have my brand of living life on the edge. The brand that I was at the time, that's why I'm a brand. That's who Logan Paul is.
I personally think that viewing yourself from the outside in, that can be very helpful to you becoming a better person, but when Logan Paul talks about it, it feels very much like he is molding a brand. He is molding a product with the intent to sell. And the way he talks about himself, it sounds like he thinks that he is a character in a fictional movie. Also hitting on a story note that people love a comeback story.
I think America in general they love redemption stories.
There are also portions of the video where it appears that he is very combative to the idea that he did something wrong. He seemingly tries to fight the idea that he was being culturally insensitive when he was just running around harassing people in Japan, trying to say, I was just being insensitive.
There's a difference between culturally insensitive and insensitive. The brand that I was at the time was just all around insensitive.
I thought that was a very weird hill for him to try and die on. When Casey Neistat pushes Logan on the Suicide Forest video about how the friends laughed and also how seemingly excited Logan was to say, hey, check out this video, you're not gonna see anything like this on YouTube. Logan seemingly only really focused on the part about the laughing, saying that was a defense mechanism.
The laughing is, it's a defense mechanism for me. That's what it
sure,
is.
Sure, I've heard you say that.
But that did not take into account that now infamous intro to the video.
Buckle the fuck up, because you're never gonna see a video like this again.
And his constant hitting on the story of what this documentary is supposed to be of, can your career survive this? Can you come back? That doesn't really match up with reality, since even he, when he came back from his month-long break, noted in his completely deflective video that he had gained 1 million subscribers because of this controversy.
What other YouTuber you know can take a 3-week break and still gain 1 million subscribers?
And also an important thing to note is this interview is happening and was released in the same time frame that the BBC, they did an interview with Logan Paul and ended up deciding not to release it. They released a preview that's been effectively scrubbed from the internet, but luckily we were able to pull it. In it, he seemingly brags that he's going to bet $1 million on himself. There was backlash to the preview. The BBC ultimately said, you know, we're not going to end up releasing it. Tweeting, after listening back to the interview, we don't feel it's right. We understand some of your strong views on Logan, but ultimately if we don't think the interview is good enough, we don't air it. But main point, here's a small piece of the preview.
Third round knockout. Mark your bets. I'm betting $1 million on myself.
Are you even gonna do that?
Yeah.
I don't know if that money is necessarily part of where he said he was not going to profit off of the documentary, even though the fight is a massive part of the documentary.
If we do decide to monetize it, 100% of the proceeds will go to some sort of suicide prevention awareness program.
And it's something that Casey hits on in the interview, that it appears that what Logan Paul is putting out in the world at different times, or even in some of the same interviews, contradicts itself. Although Logan, and I feel like he incorrectly does it, but he characterizes it as bridging the gap. Now, of course, that said, a lot of this was my personal takeaway from the interview, and I'd love to know your thoughts as well. Do you think that you're actually seeing a change with Logan Paul, or this is part of his PR campaign to rehabilitate his image? Do you feel like Casey Neistat was right or wrong to do this interview? Any and all thoughts you have on this one, I'd love to know in the comments down below. And then let's talk about Billy McFarlane. Now, for those that don't recognize that name or his bro face, he is the man that was behind the now infamous disaster known as Fyre Festival. Right, that event that all those Instagram models promoted, it was gonna be next level, and then it was just a disaster. And the thing is, for Billy, after Fyre Festival, things got even worse. In June of 2017, McFarlane ends up getting arrested. He's charged with 2 counts of wire fraud. Each count carries a maximum sentence of 20 years, and he pleads guilty. And to simplify the charges here, one, he allegedly misrepresented the company's value to be in the millions when it actually earned less than $60,000. This in order to secure investments for the company. And two, in a separate event, he reportedly provided an investor with an altered brokerage statement. Then this past Tuesday, in another case linked to Fyre Festival, the SEC announces that they've agreed to settle with McFarland and others to the tune of $27.4 million. This because they said McFarland had fraudulently induced investments into the companies. And then, oh, it's not over yet, boys and girls. McFarland ended up having to face even more fraud charges because reportedly, while on pre-trial release, before sentencing for his Fyre Festival-related charges, he launched a new scheme to sell fake tickets to events. This reportedly including the Super Bowl, Coachella, and the Met Gala. And according to prosecutors, once again, while on pre-trial release, McFarland scammed 30 people out of around $150,000. Also, because at this point he had not won the gold medal in the douchebag Olympics yet, he tried to pay one of his employees with a fraudulent check. And so fast forward to yesterday, where Billy McFarland has now pled guilty to those charges. And so that also means that altogether, McFarland faces up to 115 years in prison. But that said, his pleas are part of a plea deal, so it's believed that he will most likely serve between 11 to 14 years. But for now, we're going to have to wait to see what his sentencing will be. As of right now, it is scheduled for September 17th, and the tale of Fyre Festival is almost over if you don't also, oh god, I forgot, there's also a $5 million civil suit against him. Oh, Billy. But from that, I want to share some stuff I love today and today in Awesome, brought to you by BetterHelp.com/DeFranco. BetterHelp, if you don't know, is the fantastic place and service where you can get affordable private online counseling. Right from your computer or phone, you get access to licensed, trained, experienced, accredited psychologists, marriage and family therapists, clinical social workers, and board licensed professional counselors. And all you've got to do is go to betterhelp.com/DeFranco, you fill out a questionnaire, they match you with a counselor, and you can start counseling today. And as I always try and mention, they are not just a sponsor, they are a service I personally use and love and recommend. But of course, main point, if this sounds interesting to you, you want to check it out, betterhelp.com/DeFranco. But also a big note I want to hit on here, just because of certain stories in today's show. If you are in crisis or someone you know is in danger, do not use this site. I'll link to resources down below where you can get immediate help, but it's just, it's an important distinction there to know the difference. And the first bit of awesome today is we had our buddies over at Epic Mealtime doing the 10-minute entire KFC menu challenge, because of course they did. We had Simon Pegg breaking down his most iconic characters. We had How It Should Have Ended giving us Infinity War alternate. We also got a teaser for Dimitri Martin's new Netflix special. And if you want to see the full versions of everything I just shared, the secret link of the day, anything at all, links as always are in the description down below. Then we had the viewer-requested story around Yannette Garcia and Douglas Martin, aka Phase Sensor. And I will say, I'm surprised this became a news story. I was not going to cover it initially because I was like, oh, okay, it's a relationship thing. It's drama. Don't care. But then the story actually got picked up by some outlets and it morphed into this other weird thing. And if you're not familiar with these two, Doug is a professional gamer and Yannette is a model slash weather woman. She's usually described as the world's sexiest weather girl. And the initial way this became a story is Doug made a video and he said, we broke up. And in the video, he says he ended the relationship and the general reasoning was this.
At this time, at this moment right now in my life, I don't have time for a girlfriend. I have to focus on myself. I have to focus on what I'm doing as a career. And I just don't feel like I could give her the enough attention that she wants and that she needs, because girls need attention, girls need love. So I'm so focused on Call of Duty that I can't give her enough attention, and I can't give her the attention that she wants.
And that was it. That was the main story, and then it got picked up. And a lot of the coverage went in on Doug, mocked Doug. We also saw people doing that online. One outlet writing, struggling professional Call of Duty player Douglas Faye Sensor Martin dumped his Weather Girl girlfriend, Yannette Garcia, to spend more time with video games. Then saying he went on to say that he needed to focus on playing Call of Duty and would be playing the next iteration in the franchise. Also randomly on Twitter, you had people like Brad Takei tweeting, yes, Call of Duty should come before personal relationships, dot, dot, dot. And it's that mockery that I want to chime in on. I want to say a few things. The first is you never really know how good, how strong a couple is, how strong a relationship is just from looking at videos online or pictures online. And as Doug even mentions in the video, they were kind of at this point where they were long distance because she went to Mexico City for a job. Two, I understand the general reaction of how could you break up with Yannette Garcia? Look at her. Right? I've been that age and that mindset before, but looks are not everything. And three, I feel like there are a good number of people that are minimizing what Doug is talking about here. They're dumbing down what he is saying here as I'd rather play video games than date this girl. When what it appears that Doug Martin is trying to say is I really, really, really want to focus on my job. He appears to be at a point in his life where the thing that gives him the most value is his job, and his job is to play games, and his job specifically is to compete in games and practice and practice. It'd be along the lines of if I didn't have a wife and a kid and I just had a girlfriend and I said, you know what, building this company, that's what I need to focus on. The whole dating thing, that's not me right now. What I always think of with people is they have the triforce of focus and disappointment. You have work, family, and friends. And when you focus on one, you're obviously giving that more attention than the other two. In my personal opinion, most people that can kind of effectively handle two and focus on two, but a third usually becomes disappointment. And if you're going to throw yourself in 110% into your job, obviously the other two will suffer. I personally just see a guy that's trying to follow his dream, to feel like he's getting value out of what he is doing for work. He's trying to be the best at that thing. And if you feel like in any way your relationship is holding you back from being great or getting value or just feeling good, then that relationship is gonna fail anyway. And so I think recognizing that, if that is the legitimate reason, that's actually a mature decision. As far as if it is the right decision, ultimately it's his life, he'll know later. But I think the sooner people realize that a professional gamer or entertainment gamer, it's a legitimate job now. But of course, that's my personal takeaway from it. It's something that I wanted to chime in on, because despite people like Ninja being on ESPN, being fully respected, I think this story in a certain way shines a light on how ignorant a lot of people are to this world. But of course, like with every story, I'll pass the question off to you. And then let's talk about a story that you might have actually already seen the first part of. Last week, there was a duck boat that capsized in Missouri. This after a severe thunderstorm brought intense winds and waves. There were reportedly 31 people on board and 17 of them died. And that makes this one of the deadliest boat accidents in U.S. history. And as far as what exactly happened, right now there's an investigation. Both the National Transportation Safety Board and the Coast Guard are looking into it. Additionally, the Missouri State Highway Patrol has launched a criminal investigation. But here's what we know so far. Duck boats are boats that can drive on land and float in water. They're a really popular tourist attraction in some bigger cities like Boston and Seattle, but their unique design have some safety concerns attached to them. In the water, passengers sit close to the surface, which makes them more dangerous than a normal boat. Additionally, the cover over the hull and windows on the sides makes it difficult for passengers to exit in case of an accident. And actually, just yesterday it was reported that the man who designed the duck boat that capsized had no engineering credentials. And the thing is, the design issues have been a known thing. On Sunday, Stephen Paul, a mechanical inspector who worked on the duck boat, said he warned the company about major design flaws and safety issues a year ago. Paul saying he was hired by Ripley Entertainment last year to inspect 24 boats, and in his report he cautioned multiple things, including that the boat's engines and pumps that remove water from the hulls might fail in bad weather. That report also noting that in rough conditions, water could get into the exhaust system and then into the motor, cutting it off, and with the motor off, its pump for removing water from the hull would not operate. However, according to Fox, a source with knowledge of the report but not authorized to speak publicly about it strongly pushed back on Paul's claims. That source telling Fox there is no documentation and there were no warnings. Ride the Ducks Branson has also released a statement. In addition to saying they are deeply sad, they wrote, "We are offering to pay for all related medical bills and funeral expenses, return all personal items from the rescue scene, and assist with any related travel or accommodations that will help the families in their time of need." And then adding, "The investigation is being managed by the NTSB. Because we are a party to the NTSB investigation, we are not allowed to comment on any aspect of it." And to make this already horrible story even worse, on that note of families, reportedly one family lost 9 members in this accident. It was the Coleman family. The youngest was 1, the oldest was 70. Tia Coleman and her 13-year-old nephew were the only members of the family that were on the duck boat that survived. Tia herself losing 3 children in this incident. And in an interview, Tia hit on a note that may be the reason why there was such a high death count.
"The captain did say something about life jackets. He said, above you are your life jackets. There's 3 sizes. He said, I'm going to show you where they are, but you won't need them. So no need to worry. So we didn't grab them. No matter what, I felt like if I was able to get a life jacket, I could have saved my babies. Because they could have at least floated up to the top and somebody could have grabbed them.
And in addition to this, meteorologists and others have hit the company for having the boats out there in the first place. Dr. Marshall Shepard, the director of the University of Georgia's Atmospheric Science Program, wrote, it is 2018, not 1901. The meteorological community has advanced weather satellites, weather radar, and models. Storms like this do not, quote, come out of nowhere. This specifically in response to the president of Ripley Entertainment saying that the storm came out of nowhere. And on that note, 8 hours before the accident occurred, the National Weather Service had issued a severe thunderstorm watch for western and central Missouri. And on top of that, about 30 minutes before the boat capsized, a severe thunderstorm warning actually went out that specifically named Table Rock, which is specifically where the accident took place. And obviously, I am of the mindset that it is important for the NTSB and others to finish their investigation, but just from so much that we are seeing, this whole accident seems like on several different levels, it could have been completely avoidable. But instead, we have 17 dead, so many lives destroyed. And for now, until the investigation is over, there's no easy way to end this story. So how I do want to end this, a GoFundMe has been set up by Tia Coleman's sister to raise money for her family. And I'm linking to that down below in the description. And let's talk about that horrible shooting this week in Toronto, Canada. Sunday night, emergency services responded around 10 p.m. to reports of shots fired in Toronto's Greektown neighborhood. Witnesses describing a man dressed in black using a handgun to fire into shops and restaurants. According to police, they arrived and exchanged gunfire with the suspect before he fled, and later he was found dead on Danforth Avenue. And as of recording this video, it is unclear if he died of a self-inflicted gunshot wound or a police bullet. But the Special Investigation Unit is investigating the exchange specifically. Now, as a result of the attack, 2 were killed and 13 others were injured. The 2 killed were a 10 and an 18-year-old, and those injured ranged between 17 to 59 years old. And by late Monday afternoon, the shooter was identified. Soon after, the family of the shooter released a statement saying, "We will mourn those who were lost for the rest of our lives," adding, "Our son had severe mental health challenges, struggling with psychosis and depression his entire life. The interventions of professionals were unsuccessful. Medications and therapy were unable to treat him. While we did our best to seek help for him throughout his life of struggle and pain, we could never imagine that this would be his devastating and destructive end." And with the family mentioning mental health here, of course, there is the question of, okay, well, what was the motive? Was it a mental health issue? Was it something else? As of now, the police have not announced the motive of the attack. Although on Tuesday, the Islamic State said that the shooter was, quote, a soldier of the Islamic State and carried out the attack in response to calls to target the citizens of the coalition countries. However, Toronto Police Chief Mark Saunders says that at this stage, we have no evidence to support these claims, adding, "Accurate information about this investigation will only be released by the Toronto Police Service. We will continue to explore every investigative avenue, including interviewing those who knew the shooter, reviewing his online activity, and looking into his experiences with mental health." And until we get more information about this specific shooting, the question is, well, what now? How do we keep people safe? The timing of this attack is notable. It comes just days after Toronto put 200 additional officers on patrol in certain neighborhoods between the hours of 7 p.m. and 3 a.m. Between those specific hours is when the most shootings occur in Toronto. We also saw on Tuesday the Toronto City Council pass measures aimed at gun safety, and they passed it with an overwhelming vote of 41-4. The measure is also aiming to push the Canadian government to ban the sale of handguns, and also for the provincial governments to ban handgun ammunition sales within the city. But there have also been those arguing that it is not a gun issue, since this attack comes just 3 months after the van attack in Toronto that resulted in 10 dead and 16 injured. And as far as what happens next politically, of course, we have to watch. As far as the investigation, we have to let them investigate. But of course, like always with stories like this, I want to send my thoughts and well wishes to the victims here. And if you'd like to help, I'll link down below. There's a Toronto Strong Fund for the victims in the description down below. And then let's talk about this news about Michael Cohen and Donald Trump. Yesterday, CNN published a report claiming that according to anonymous sources, Trump's former lawyer, Michael Cohen, alleges that Trump actually did have knowledge of the now infamous Trump Tower meeting. According to that report, Cohen alleges that he was present along with several others when Trump was informed of the Russians' offer by Trump Jr. By Cohen's account, Trump approved going ahead with the meeting with the Russians. The source is also going on to say that he was willing to give this information to Robert Mueller. And while if this turns out to be true, this is massive news. According to the sources, Cohen also doesn't have documentation or recordings to corroborate this claim. But still, if true, this would be a massive deal because it would show Trump and his associates weren't telling the truth about his knowledge of the meeting. Now, as far as who is the source, who is putting this information out there, according to Lanny Davis, who is Michael Cohen's lawyer, he said, "I cannot comment, and I have to wonder why the Trump people would put that out. It was not from us." And as far as the response from the other side, we saw Rudy Giuliani go on TV saying this about Cohen.
"Well, which lie do you want to pick? You want to pick the first lie, the second lie, or maybe some new lie? There's nobody that I know that knows him that hasn't warned me that if he's back his up against the wall, he'll lie like crazy because he's lied all his life.
And I will say it was very interesting to see Giuliani say that, because just back in May, he was saying this about Cohen.
He doesn't have any incriminating evidence about the president or himself. The man is an honest, honorable lawyer.
So Giuliani describing him as an honest, honorable lawyer, and then separately now says, I haven't met anyone that's not like, watch out for that guy, he'll lie. It's almost as if Giuliani will say anything regardless of what reality is or what he actually feels. But who knows if that is true. As far as President Trump's reaction, he took to Twitter to say, I did not know of the meeting with my son, Don Jr. Sounds to me like someone is trying to make up stories in order to get himself out of an unrelated jam. Taxi cabs, maybe? He even retained Bill and at Hillary's lawyer. Gee, I wonder if they helped him make the choice. And that last part is in reference to Cohen's legal troubles regarding taxi cabs. But for now, that is where we are with this story, and it will be interesting to see if there are any more recordings that come out soon. It will be interesting to see if there are any more claims coming out soon. But for now, we wait. And that's where I'm going to end today's show. And of course, remember, this is the PDS. It is not just a show, it is a conversation. So whether it's the last story, the first one, anything in between, let me know what you're thinking in those comments down below. Also, remember, if you like today's show, hit that like button. If you're new here, hit that subscribe button, ring that bell just for giggles, and or to get notifications when new daily weekday videos come out, or every now and then I do a surprise video. But that said, of course, as always, my name's Philip DeFranco. You've just been filled in. I love yo faces, and I'll see you Monday.